Welcome out this Sunday evening to the Potter's House, Footscray. So glad you could make it with us tonight. Hope you've had a great day. Our fathers out there, if you're in the local area, we're glad you could join us. If you're a bit more north in the Gulf of Carpentaria, we're also glad you can join us. If you're even in the nation of Algeria, way even further north, we're glad you could live stream with us this evening. We're looking forward to a great time. A personal testimony from Pastor Darren Spruce. We're going to begin tonight lifting up our voices. Why don't you stand to your feet? Brother Gavin Spruce is going to get us started. Hallelujah. Let's go to the mountain of our God, worship Him and praise Him. Let's lift our voices tonight. Let everything, amen. Sing out with us tonight. Clap your hands. Soul. If we could see how much you're worth, your power, your might, your endless love, then surely we would never cease to praise. Let everything I mean, everything that has breath, praise the Lord, that calling all the nations to your praise. If they could see how much you're worth, your power, your might, your endless love, and surely they would never cease to we do give you thanks and praise. Let everything, my God, give you glory and honor. Hallelujah. Bless you, my Father. We praise you. Be lifted up this night on the praises of your people. Hallelujah. Amen. Let's sing it out this night over all the earth. Hallelujah. Over all the earth, you reign on high. Every mountain stream, every sunset sky. But my one request, Lord, my only aim, is that you reign in me again. Lord, reign in me, reign in your power, over all my dreams, in my darkest hour. You are the Lord of all I am. Oh, won't you reign in me again? Yes, indeed, you would reign this night. Every thought, sing it out. Over every thought, over every word, may my life reflect the beauty of my Lord. Cause you mean more to me than any earthly thing. So won't you reign in me again? Lord, reign in me, reign in your power, over all my dreams, in my darkest. Sunset sky, but my one request, Lord, my only aim, is that you reign in me again. Lord, reign. this place this night. Continue to lift up your voices, amen. I'm going to slow things down, singing out with us. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, amen. As we worship his holy name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. I'll worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I'll worship his holy name. As we sing it out tonight, the sun comes up. The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Why don't you lift your voice and hands with us tonight? Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. I'll worship his holy name and sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I'll worship your holy name. We're singing out this evening, you're rich in love. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Sing it out again tonight and on that day, amen. And on that day when my strength is failing, the angels near and my time. Thank you, Lord. you, my God. We will bless you, my King. Oh, indeed, your name is lifted high. The Lord our God is God. He is the King of glory. He is the Lord of hosts. Oh, the one who is, who was, and is to come. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. This special day, this Father's Day, this evening, we want to begin our service in prayer. Amen. We want to remember these churches, these pastors and their families. Let's pray for the churches in Melton and Box Hill, also the Matthews in Bangalore in India. Amen. We lifted up Pastor Clark this morning in the nation of Guam. We also want to continue to lift him up once again this evening. God's hand would be upon him. God would heal him. Hallelujah. And also, as well as that, we have a request from Tabana, Brother Tabana in our church. Many of the church have been praying for him and just want to lift him up also. He is so thankful that the church would come before God and lift him up in prayer. He's been doing very well and he's believing that he's going to be totally healed. So thank you, Footscray Church. Continue to lift up these things. I mean, why don't we lift our voices? Join us this evening as we pray. We're believing God to move in this special testimony tonight. Why don't we lift our voices as we come before God's throne? Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Once again, we can come before your throne in prayer, my God, in supplication, my King. Make me anxious for nothing, my Lord, but believe in you, Father, to move upon Pastor Clark, my God. Lord, indeed, you'd raise him up, my God. We thank you, Father, for what you've done with Taban, my God. We're believing your hand be upon these churches, in Melton, Father, in Box Hill, Lord, upon the Matthews, my God, in India, Father. We thank you for all that you would do, my King. Do a miracle, I pray, in and through this time, Lord Jesus. Use this testimony tonight. Touch hearts and lives. We thank you, Father, for all that you would do. We thank you for these things in Jesus' name. Why do we praise him tonight? Amen. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Bless you, my King. Thank you.
Amen. Praise God. I do want to welcome everybody out tonight to our Sunday evening service. Really looking forward to all that God's going to do. Just quickly, before we get to some announcements, I just want to extend a very big happy Father's Day to all our dads that are watching our live stream tonight. I hope you had a fantastic day and continue to have a great night. And then also, one other thing, I want to extend a very special happy Father's Day on behalf of the Footscray Church, on behalf of everybody watching the live stream, to Pastor Elliot. We do thank you and appreciate you for your commitment to all that you've done for our church. And we love and appreciate you and looking forward to having church with everybody. Amen. Praise God. Now, just quickly, a few announcements of things that are coming up for this next week. Beginning tomorrow night, we have our Monday night parenting support group. That's run by Brother Sean Ewan and Gavin Spruce. I encourage you, if you're not a part of that, reach out to one of these gentlemen. Get involved. That's tomorrow night, Monday night. And then also, on the Wednesday night, we have our Wednesday service at 7:30. Really looking forward to our midweek top-up. I encourage you, the stream starts at 7:15 p.m. Jump online, be ready, be prepared, open your heart up, and God will speak to you. Amen. Also, looking ahead, Thursday night, we have the Healthy Headspace support group. That's at 6 p.m. with Brother Andrew Sutton. Once again, if you haven't been to one of these events, you're single, you're looking for something to do, I encourage you, reach out. Brother Andrew has more details on that. They're going fantastic, and God's really helping them on that. Amen. Also, looking ahead, Friday night, we're doing a Bible study series on overcoming life. Pastor Elliot's running that. I encourage you, once again, be there, be ready, 7:15. Don't forget, that's an open dialogue chat. So, John, in, have the live chat ready, be involved in it, questions and answers, and God will really help us there on overcoming coronavirus. Amen. Also, looking ahead, next Sunday, don't forget our Sunday services, 10:30 in the morning, 6 p.m. in the evening. I encourage you, schedule it into your calendar. Make sure you're always there and always ready for Sunday morning service. Amen. That's all our announcements this morning. Let's give God praise as we go to the offering. Yes, Father God, hallelujah, God, hallelujah, amen, praise God. You know, in 2017, I not long moved to the Footscray Potter's House Church from Bendigo, and I started an apprenticeship doing landscaping at a company called Coolabah. And so I was earning a low wage. I was just trying to make my way in the church in the city of Melbourne as a new disciple and a new member of the church. And I've been doing that for about 6 months. And then in June 2017, I had a car accident. I hit two cars, damaged both my car and their cars. And so it wasn't the greatest time. Obviously, like I mentioned, I'm on a low income. I'm struggling. I'm fighting. I'm trying to do things what I want to do and trying to make my own path. And anyway, so I was in this battle. I was financially struggling and I felt like things were going against me. And so what happened, it was actually in the morning. I'm on my way to morning prayer. So it's about 5:30 in the morning. I'm driving just on Essex Street up the road. I have this car accident. The tow trucks come. The police come. Everything gets sorted out. And then I realized the time was 7 in the morning. And I know that there's faithful people from our church constantly every morning, Monday to Friday, praying between 7 and 8 in the morning. And so I'm decided, you know what? It's 7 o'clock in the morning. I make the godly decision to head down to prayer despite what's happened. And I go there just praying and asking, trying to be faithful and just putting my trust in God that, you know what, I don't know what's going to happen, but I trust God. Amen. And then a few weeks later, I was in church one evening. I just opened the church and a brother come in nice and early. And he come up to me and he handed me an envelope. And he just said, I felt really stirred by God to give you this envelope. I continue to do what you're doing in God, and God's going to help you. Amen. And so I was very encouraged. I was felt very blessed. And then I remember I went home and I opened the envelope, and that's where the real miracle began. Because in that envelope, the sum of money that was inside that envelope almost perfectly covered the expenses of the accident. And so in that moment, I remember thinking that despite my dramas, despite the test of my faith in that time where I wasn't sure what was going to happen, God come through and God provided for me in my time of need. And Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5-6 says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him and he shall direct your path." So tonight, as we look to take up this offering, I'm encouraging you in your place to trust in God. Allow God, as you go to give, to direct your path. And I want to challenge you right now. Take out your device. Take out whatever you have, your phone, your iPad, your computer. Turn it on. Log in. Get it ready. And I encourage you, open your heart up and put your trust in God. And also, church members, don't forget to be faithful in your tithes, your offerings, your world evangelism pledges. Perhaps you haven't given with us tonight or given with us yet. You'll see on the screen, it'll pop up the church account details, the BSB. I encourage you, put that into your bank details, save it and give and believe and trust in God. And just as I experienced a miracle in my life, I'm believing tonight that you can also experience a miracle to happen in your life. Amen. Let's close our eyes. I'm going to pray. Yes, Father God, we thank you for the opportunity to give and invest into your kingdom, God. I'm praying your blessing, my God, upon this offering, God. I pray right now, God, you would stir hearts, God. Let us have faith to trust, God, faith to believe that you are on the throne in the midst of our situation. I'm praying, God, by faith, my God, you would bless the gift and the giver in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. Let's give faithfully. Amen.
See now tonight, you won't leave it like it came. You won't leave it like it came in Jesus' name. Bound, oppressed, tormented, sick or lame. For the Holy Ghost of Acts is still the same.
Amen. Praise God. Thank you, musicians. Tonight, very quickly before we get to the preaching, we're very blessed to have some special music. So where you are, put your hands together and welcome Rachel Avista May.
Woo-hoo. Come on. Yes.
Thanks, Caleb. I hope everyone is doing well out there tonight, and I'm going to sing a song called Free, and I hope it blesses you.
Hurting heart and broken wings cannot stop your love from always finding me. No more days wasting away. can just breathe. The world I tried so hard to please, there's no hold on me. My strength alone will never be enough, but your arms keep lifting me up. You tell me I'll be made free. You give me everything I need to walk in my dreams. You whisper words to free my soul.
Amen. What a blessing to have tremendous music. We thank you, Rachel, and the musicians for that tonight. As you know, many of you are aware that we've been doing a special Pastor's Life Before Christ. It's been a great blessing. It's been fantastic. And tonight's going to be another special night. I really encourage you to tune in, get ready for God to speak to your heart. And all the way from Bendigo, I'm so blessed to announce my own dad and Pastor Darren Spruce. Let's welcome him tonight. Amen.
Thank you. Praise God. Hallelujah. Great to be here tonight. Very excited to be able to come and share my testimony. I appreciate the opportunity. Thank you to Pastor Elliot. And I just want to say a quick hello to the Bendigo Saints and who are watching. Yeah, I remember one morning I was traveling, or I was going to be traveling from Newcastle to Sydney for work. I was with my dad, and I got up and we turned on the radio. And I heard on the radio that morning that my friend, Peter White, had died. Yeah, I was in shock. I couldn't believe it. And I found out later that his Harley Davidson was getting fixed. It was at the mechanics, and his dad, you know, dropped him off there to pick that up. And Peter White rode only a couple of blocks after picking up that Harley Davidson. And a car went through an orange light, knocked him off his Harley, and his head hit the gutter right on his forehead. And he was pronounced dead by the time the ambulance reached the hospital. Yeah, that morning, you know, I was rattled. It really shook me up. And as my dad and I drove to Sydney that morning, yeah, my head was all over the place. White is dead. He's so young. 22. Yeah, what a waste of a life. Yeah, by the time I was 25, about 13 of my close school friends had stepped into eternity. They were laying in a grave somewhere. Yeah, my two closest friends, Murray, he broke up with his girlfriend and drove his car into a river and he drowned. Adam was a Christian for a short time. He fell back into the world and he overdosed on drugs. See, others were mainly freak accidents. But you know what? This began to mess with my head. I'm looking for answers. Life didn't make any sense. So I began to question life. Why do people die so young? What's life all about? And what is my purpose? See, at this point in my life, life didn't seem to have any answers. And then on the 25th of May, 1996, I asked Jesus Christ into my heart to be my Lord and Savior. I become a Christian, and I want to declare to you tonight that my life was changed. My life was transformed. And tonight we're going to look in the Bible in Ecclesiastes chapter 12, and we're going to begin in verse 1. And I want to give my testimony, and I've entitled it, The Vanity of Life. Ecclesiastes 12, beginning in verse 1. We're going to just skip through a few verses of this chapter. And the Bible says, Remember now your Creator in the days of your youth, before the difficult days come, and the years draw near when you say, I have no pleasure in them. Verse 8 says, Vanity of vanities, says the preacher. All is vanity. And verses 13 and 14, the Bible says, Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep His commandments, for this is man's all. For God will bring every work into judgment, including every secret thing, whether good or evil. As we begin tonight, I want to think about my upbringing. See, in our text, these are the words of Solomon. And he was regarded as the smartest man ever to live. He understood life. He had wisdom. He had wealth. And everything that this world offered was at his very fingertips. In our text in verse 8, it says, Vanity of vanities, says the preacher. All is vanity. In 2 Peter 3:9, the Bible says, The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. See, tonight, God is looking to bring every person to this very place, this place of repentance, a place where they can know Jesus Christ in a personal way. And it's in this place where lives are transformed, and it's through Jesus that addictions are broken. People are set free. Tonight, hope is found in Jesus. See, there's no situation that is too hard for Jesus. In John 8:36, the Bible says, Therefore, the Son makes you free, you shall be free indeed. I grew up in a household where we believed in God, but we didn't know God. My parents were together. They had good morals. I believed in heaven. I believed in hell. And you see, I believed that I was a good person. I believed that I would be good enough. And I believed that that would get me into heaven. Now, my parents were passionate about rugby league. Yeah, my dad played rugby league for Western Suburbs in Newcastle. He played something like 220 first grade games. So my dad's standards when it comes to rugby league were very high. Yeah, I began to play when I was about 6 years old. I played for a number of years, and when I was about probably 12 or 13, a friend introduced me to motorbikes, and once I got into motorbikes, I said later for rugby league, I wanted to ride motorbikes. I wanted to go down the local creek and all the tracks and burn around and have some fun with my friends. And my dad, it's funny, because my dad used to call motorbike riders temporary Australians. And meaning that you're on a motorbike, you're only here for a temporary time. So as a result, I was never allowed to have a motorbike. My parents were dead set against them. But you know, I pulled a few strings and I managed to get my hands on a motorbike. I bought that motorbike home. And I'll tell you, my parents hit the roof. It was on for the young and old. I said, it's only here for one night. That one night turned into years. But you know, with motorbikes, I ended up getting in a lot of trouble with the police. I was always in trouble. I remember a time, you know, I was with a couple of friends on our trail bikes burning around, and yeah, we were on this gravel road going up the side of a football oval, and just as we hit the main sort of highway, or not really highway, a back street there, we began to cross this road, and coming down the road there's a police wagon. And we've quickly turned around and off we go. We're riding these motorbikes trying to get away from the police. They're chasing us. And you won't believe what happened. My chain came off. I've quickly dropped the bike and begin to run. And then I realize, you know what? This motorbike's not mine. I can't afford to get the bike taken off us. So I run back to the bike. I just went to the police and I was very fortunate. They let me off very lightly. You know, this was my life. This is where I was at. I was thinking about another time. And this is an ongoing thing. A friend of mine down the road, we used to wait till our parents went to bed. And we'd sneak out to the garage, get the motorbikes out, and we'd get riding these motorbikes all hours of the night. Until, again, the police caught up with us. This is what we used to do. Then as we're getting a little bit older, yeah, our family, every year, we used to go to the Golden Slipper horse race in Sydney. My parents loved to watch the horses, and on this occasion, I was allowed to stay home. So I invited the friends over on the Saturday night where the family's in Sydney, had a bit of a party. And all weekend, motorbikes are coming and going, and we just partied on. But Mum and Dad, they come home Monday morning, the police are knocking at the door. I caused my parents a lot of grief. They hated these motorbikes. You know, around the same time that I was into motorbikes, I was introduced into drugs, and our next-door neighbour introduced us into drugs. We get into marijuana, smoking a little bit of marijuana. I tried speed. Someone put speed in my drink, and I had that from time to time. I wasn't a drug addict or anything like that, but I dabbled. Now, Solomon said in Ecclesiastes chapter 1, verse 14, he said, I have seen all the works that are done under the sun, and indeed all is vanity and grasping for the wind. See, Solomon talked about life under the sun. He's saying that life is vanity. Life in this world is meaningless. And for me, left to myself, I seem to just go from one situation to the next. I was in trouble in this area, then that area. Now, I opened up tonight speaking about my friends. My friends dying so young. I believe that this brought me to a place where I was questioning life. What is the point? What's going on? What is life really about? Yeah, from the time I left school, yeah, I started working. I was able to save money. I was buying motorbikes and trikes and quads and got right into cars. And I'm trying all these things. Yeah, I had it all on the outside. Well, that's what I thought anyway. But, you know, inside I was empty. Inside, something was missing in my life. I was searching. In verse 8 of our text, it says, Vanity of vanity, says the preacher, all is vanity. I want to think secondly tonight about an encounter with God. Because, you know, God meets people at all different places in life. I was thinking about Charles Spurgeon. He was converted when he was 15 years old. He was out in the cold one London morning and couldn't stand the cold any longer. So he went into a Methodist church to get warm. And it was in this Methodist church where he got saved. And Charles Spurgeon went on to see God move in his life in a very powerful way. Now, for me, I became a Christian in a car park. How can that happen, you might wonder? Well, I'm glad you asked. But you have to wait a little bit longer before I give you the answer. I began working in my parents' business in about 1990. And it was this time that one of my closest friends became a Christian. And, you know, I thought Christianity was more of a belief rather than having a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. In John 10:10, the Bible says the thief does not come in except to steal and to kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and they may have it more abundantly. You know, Jesus came to take away the emptiness. Jesus came to give us a purpose and a destiny, and the truth is found in Jesus Christ. And this is what I come to realize. As I'm navigating my way through life, as I'm trying to find some answers in my life. In 1993, I met Naomi and we began to date. And it's funny because when her parents, she was from Armidale, was living in Newcastle. She moved to Newcastle to go to university. But when her parents found out that she was dating someone, one of the first questions that her parents asked was, "He's not religious, is he?" And she said, "Oh, no, of course not." But yeah, right at that time, my two brothers become Christians. Started going to the Potter's House Church. And again, you know, I saw my brothers get changed. I could see a definite change within their lives. And you know what? They were on fire. They were on fire. All we would hear is Jesus this, Jesus that. Always telling us about Jesus, like, enough. Give us a break. So every time we would catch up, it'd be all about Jesus. They'd be trying to convert us. They'd say, "Jesus loves you. He died for you. Repent or burn." See, they were very excited. But to me, it's like, what have you been drinking? What's going on? You've gone nuts. Have you lost your mind? See, I really thought that being a good person was enough. I thought that would get me into heaven. In John 11:12, Jesus spoke to them again, saying, "I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life." See, I believed in Jesus in my own way. But now looking back, it's like my beliefs didn't have any power because I wasn't born again. I didn't know Jesus Christ in a personal way. But, you know, as I went through life and looking at my brother's lives, it brought me to a place where I began to ask some questions. I begin to question my beliefs. And by now, Naomi and I are living together. She began nursing and working long hours. So I had a lot of time where I was at home on my own. And I'd find myself just, you know, thinking about life. Wondering what's the point of this life? See, life wasn't making any sense. And then one day, you know, I remember visiting my parents, and Gavin just happened to be there, and it was on. He's telling me about Jesus and how I need to be saved, and it was like, you know, everywhere I went, he's got his Bible open, he's following me around, trying to win me. And you know what? I actually prayed a prayer that day. But I didn't mean it. It was just to get him to stop preaching to me. And both Gavin and Shane, my brothers, they're trying to convert us all throughout this time. It came to the point where Naomi and I decided to go to church and get them to stop inviting us. Then we could say that, you know what, we've been to church, we've checked it out, now leave us alone. So we went. And it just so happened they were in revival, there's an evangelist preaching there. At the time I had a bit of a thick black beard. And at the end of the service, the evangelist was praying for the sick. And he goes, hey, lickety-split, come on over here, come and see a miracle. And, you know, I'm embarrassed. Everyone's laughing. And, you know, my experience in church at that time, it wasn't great. In fact, I left with a bad taste in my mouth, but I probably should have expected that anyway before my motive for even going. You know what? It was probably a couple of years by the time I heard the gospel, and by the time I became a Christian. But I needed time to grow. I needed time to understand what was happening in Mark 4, 3 through to 9. It, you know, it talks about the sower planting seeds in different areas, but it reads it from, let's read it from Mark 4, 8 and 9, where it says, but other seed fell on good ground and yielded a crop that sprang up, increased and produced some 30-fold, some 60, and some 100. And he said to them, he who has ears to hear, let him hear. See, my change of heart started when Gavin joined a band. He came up over to my house and brought along a CD for me to listen to. And you know, introduced me to the music that was going to be, church band was going to be playing. And you know, Naomi and I were married by this time, expecting our first child. And he invited Naomi and myself to go along to this concert. And I invited my Christian friend. I needed some support because I really lacked confidence. So we went along to this concert and we heard the band and people share testimonies of what Jesus had done in their lives. And at the end of the concert, there was an altar call. But I didn't respond. I didn't respond. I was too self-conscious. Even though I felt I needed to, because you know, my heart was pounding. But I just couldn't bring myself to a place where I would draw that much attention to myself. Yeah, afterwards at the car, in the car park, and my friend confronted me and asked me if I wanted to become a Christian and ask Jesus Christ into my heart. Yeah, that night I prayed. And you know, something changed in my life. I felt different. The weight that I was carrying had been lifted. So I realized at that point in time that I need more of this. I need to go to church. You know, I went to church. I went along to the potter's house. And you know, the experience was amazing. I felt acceptance. I felt loved. And most importantly, I sensed the presence of God, that he was there. And that he had a plan, a purpose, and a destiny. I was thinking about verse 12 of our text. And it says, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. It says, fear God and keep his commandments, for this is man's all. In the NIV, it says, for this is the duty of all mankind. In the Good News, it says, for the mouth speaks what the heart is full of. I want to think thirdly and finally at my new venture in Jesus Christ. Because how many know tonight that the Christian life is an adventure? It's an adventure. You know, someone said these words, this life is long enough to make a decision. I made a decision on the 25th of May, 1996, and as a result, my life was changed. And 24 years down the road, guess what? It's still changing. See, when we surrender our hearts to Jesus, He equips us, He helps us, He moves within our lives. You know, I want to think about three of my most memorable times since being a Christian. Number one is when I told Naomi that I had become a Christian, she cried. She cried. And that was because she grew up believing that Christianity was foolishness. We'd only been married a very short time, and it wasn't what she was expecting. So for myself, the next 6 months were a real challenge. See, Naomi wasn't accepting of me being a Christian. And as a new Christian, I'd make mistakes. And she'd say, "What's that? You call yourself a Christian?" But as we fellowship with the saints, we would get invited. Invites to fellowship and hanging out with the other different other saints in the church there. And they would say, "Why are they inviting me? I'm not even a Christian." But we would go along. And she'd build relationships. People were working with her. And through this and my testimony, she began to see firsthand that God was real. God was working in her life. Then 6 months later, she became a Christian. And Naomi had her own encounter with God and got saved. But that's her testimony. So if you want to hear more, you need to ask her. Number two, the second reference point is when I left my place of employment. So I left the family business because of some of the choices that I was making. Those choices were violating my conscience, such as being told to lie. Something would go wrong. I'd say, "Oh, you know, this happened or that happened." But you know what? As a Christian, it's like it didn't sit right anymore. So I decided I needed to make a fresh start. In verses 14, 13 and 14 of our text, it says, "Fear God and keep His commandments, for this is man's all, for God will bring every work into judgment, including every secret thing, whether good or evil." See, I had to make a righteous stand. You know what? When Christians make a righteous stand, I believe that that gets God's attention. And 2 years after I made that righteous stand, God blessed me with my own business. See, we reap what we sow. God keeps good books, and God is a rewarder. Yeah, I remember when Gavin was pioneering in Maitland, we went along to a revival service there, and evangelist Mick Listing was preaching, and he called me out the front just in the, as we were running that business, and he said that God was going to give me more money. And he said, "You're not going to have to work any harder to get it." I mean, that's a good word. I was bouncing off the walls. All the bros were, "Oh, give me some of this." They're excited. Number three, in 2009, I was given the opportunity to preach the gospel. In Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 8, the Bible says, the end of the thing is better than its beginning. The patient in spirit is better than the proud in spirit. In 2009, my family and I had the privilege to go to pioneer a church in Canberra. And in Canberra, I experienced God move in numbers of supernatural ways within my life. We saw lives touched and impacted, many people saved. But you know, one time, I got a hernia. I hurt myself. I got a hernia and I was in a lot of pain. I'd be up there preaching. I couldn't stand for any longer than sort of 20-odd minutes, and I'd be in agony. And Steve Zapata was there, our evangelist from Perth, and he prayed for me. And that night, I got totally healed. Never had to have an operation. God touched my life in a powerful way. And for me, that was a reference point. In 2012, we had the opportunity to go and take over the Bendigo Potter's House Church. And yet the Bendigo people are amazing. They've been such a blessing to us, and we love serving God there. But you know, in the Bendigo Church, this is a time where our kids really begin to develop. They begin to grow. They begin to have their own, you know, personal relationships with God. And it's interesting now that, you know, Shani is married to Brent Underwood, and they're pastoring in New Zealand. Caleb is married to Victoria, living for God as the outreach director here in the Footscray Church. And Kamea, Raina and Levi are serving God with us in the Bendigo Church. See, our children were raised in the church, which gave them a great start in their journey with God. You know, I was just thinking about this and what I've spoken about tonight. And you know what? I didn't have the perfect Christian upbringing. But you know what? Our merciful God reached down from heaven and he still touched my life. Just as he can yours tonight. Whatever the circumstances you may find yourself in tonight, Jesus Christ can help you. He can touch, he can transform your situation. See, Jesus Christ gave me hope. He gave me purpose. He gave me a destiny filled with a future. See, today Jesus Christ is alive and he loves you. I'm bringing this to a close. And he loves you so much that he went to the cross and he died for your sins. He paid, God gave his very best so that you too can know Jesus Christ in a personal way. My life changed the very moment I acknowledged Jesus Christ and made him my personal Lord and Savior. I recognize him going to the cross and dying for my sins. Isaiah 64 verse 6 says, but we are like an unclean thing, and all our righteousnesses are like filthy rags. See, God has given me a hope. He's given me a destiny. He has a future for my life, just like he does your life tonight. Why don't we just bow our heads and close our eyes tonight as I bring this to a close. Jesus Christ loves you, and he loves you so much that he went to the cross and he died on that cross for your sins. Yeah, it doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter what you might have done in your life. Jesus loves you. And he loves you and he desires to have a personal relationship with you tonight. Tonight, you know, I've shared my testimony. I've spoken about what God has done within my life. And tonight, if you're not a Christian, If you don't know Jesus Christ in a personal way, well, tonight He loves you. And He loves you so much that He died on that cross for you. The Bible says the wages of sin is death. Sin separates us from God. But the good news tonight is that Jesus went to the cross and He paid the ultimate price for our sins. Tonight, if you don't know Jesus Christ in a personal way, if you're not a Christian, tonight I want to lead you through a prayer. Why don't you follow along? I'll pray tonight. You pray the words that I speak. Repeat after me. Lord Jesus, please forgive me of my sins. Jesus, I'm asking you tonight to come into my heart and be Lord of my life. Jesus, I believe that you died upon the cross for me, God. And you rose again on the third day to give me life. Thank you, Jesus. Be my Lord and my Savior. Tonight, if you've prayed this prayer, I encourage you to get in contact with Pastor Stowers. His number will come on the screen now. Message Pastor Stowers, and so he can get in contact with you and encourage you and help you to know Jesus Christ in a personal way. I want to change the call tonight. I want to talk to the church. If you're a Christian, you have a testimony. You have a story to tell. Tonight, perhaps as I'm sharing my testimony, maybe God has spoken to you about your testimony. Tonight, I want to open the altar. Why don't we just come and spend a moment of time in prayer as Pastor Stowers sings a song tonight. The altar's open. Let's find a place to pray.
Lord, you are more precious than silver. And Lord, you are more costly than gold. Oh Lord, you are more beautiful than diamonds, and nothing I desire compares with you. Lord,
opportunity, the privilege to be able to come and share my story tonight. Tonight, you know what? You have a story to tell. Tell somebody, encourage someone of the goodness and the grace and the merciful God that we serve. I do thank you. And why don't we just give God some praise tonight as Pastor comes.
Well, thank you for that, Pastor Spruce. That was great. We appreciate that. And thank God for the brothers who were full-on witnesses. Amen. Thank God for them, and we appreciate that. We want to close our service tonight. It's been a great day, and we want to believe God for a great evening. Amen. Ahead for you tonight. And remember, tomorrow night is our parenting and family support group on Monday. and a few groups and a few situations. And then Wednesday, our midweek service at 7:30, looking forward to all that God's going to do. God bless you. Have a great rest of the evening. Thank you very much from the Potter's House in Footscray. Thank you.
I was broken. It should have been me. It should have been me. Mercy, mercy, heard my cry. Mercy, mercy, saved my life. You carried all of my burdens. You took them all in that grave. I know you didn't deserve it, but you took my place. You traded hope for my hurting. You bore the weight of my shame. I know you didn't deserve it, and I know it should have been me.
only